My name is Amir Kuperman. I'm a pediatric hematologist from the Galileo Medical Center in Israel. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to speak in this lovely meeting. It's an extremely pleasure and also honor for me. And my task is to walk you through the developmental hemostasis and practical aspects for you, neonatologists. This is a topic which I deal in my everyday practice, and I think also do you. So understanding developmental hemostasis is crucial for you neonatologists, because over-diagnosis and misdiagnosis of hemostatic disorders in neonates may lead to the administration of wrong and potentially harmful treatments. Now, I know to appreciate the good work neonatologists do, because here is me 14 and a half years ago with my daughter. She was born after 31 weeks of gestation, and she was released after 2 weeks healthy to home, and this is now. So thank you for the great job you are doing. So I will be focusing on evaluation and interpretation of hemostasis in newborns, and I will divide my talk into... And I will divide my talk into three parts. First of all, I would like to introduce the field of developmental hemostasis, which I will talk about physiology and pathophysiology. And then I will talk about laboratory testing. And I will finish with some therapeutic considerations for you clinicians. So I would like to start with telling you that hematology is important, and a study published last year in the PLOS Biology showed, it's based on calculations, showed that more than 90% of the human cells in the body are actually blood cells. I mean by numbers, not by mass, not by weight, but just by numbers. And if you combine erythrocytes, platelets, and bone marrow cells, you get with more than 90% of body cells. So hematology is important. And in that, neonatal hematology is a huge field, and this is topics which you all know. It involves the neonatal erythrocyte, the immune hemolytic diseases, the disorders of the bilirubin metabolism, but I will be focusing on my talk on developmental hemostasis. And I would like to start with talking about coagulation system in general. And you know that the coagulation system is perfectly balanced. It has to be perfectly balanced, because otherwise unwanted things will happen. And this on this state, we have the pro-coagulant factors and also the anticoagulant factors. The pro-coagulant factors are meant to prevent blood loss from every small cut that we have, and also restrict the activity, the coagulant activity, to the site of injury. While the anticoagulant factors, they meant to keep blood at fluid state. It's fluid state, so it can circulate and reach every organ and every tissue, and also to meet some prothrombotic challenges that may occur during life. Now, the system is balanced, but there can be several kinds of balance. So let's look at a stable balance, which means you can imagine that this ball is the coagulation system, and something can move it to some procoagulant situation, like sepsis or immobilization, let's say, or to the other to the anticoagulant, like maybe surgery. But you should bear in mind that things can play both sides. I mean, sepsis can be procoagulant or anticoagulant as well. But let's see, maybe you can think that something pushes the ball, the coagulation system, to one side, but then the system has the ability to go back to its place. And I would argue that this is the situation in healthy adults. Well, an unstable balance, which means that if the coagulation system is in balance, but something pushes it away, a small deviation tends to grow, and I would argue that this is the situation of a sick or premature newborn. Now, neonates are more vulnerable for hemostatic complications. So you can see the balance in adults, whereas the balance in neonates is is less stable, and you can see that on this tape there are less factors, either coagulation and anticoagulation factors. There are less on the stake, and it is more unstable than the situation in adults. But you should bear in mind that there are limitations for assessing hemostasis. There are two basic limitations. First of all, there's currently no mechanism for assessing or testing the hemostatic system in its true physiological state. And what we usually do, all laboratory tests, they isolate a specific component of the system and assess this component under artificial constructs. So, for instance, if I would take all those parts and try to assess each part differently, would I be able to say that this is a system that is meant for riding? So this approach causes a lot of lack of understanding about coagulation. And to complicate the situation, you should not expect clinical trials in coagulation, because appropriate clinical trials, laboratory trials, have not been and perhaps will never be undertaken in neonates regarding coagulation. So I will now try to overview coagulation system and then move forward to developmental hemostasis. So for simplification, we divide this system into three parts: the primary hemostasis, the secondary hemostasis, and also tertiary hemostasis. But we know that this is not the situation which occurs in vivo, because when we look with intervital microscopy into thrombus formation in animals, we see that those processes occur simultaneously. But for simplification, I will go each stage separately. So primary hemostasis is the cellular interactions of platelets and the endothelium. And it starts with bleed, with a tear in the endothelial surface of a blood vessel. Then what happens is that platelets adhere using the von Willebrand factor, which is a protein that adheres platelets to the subendothelial surface. Now those platelets, they change their shapes, and they secrete the granules, and then they recruit more platelets, which form altogether in the platelet aggregation, or the hemostatic plaque. And this is the primary hemostasis. The secondary hemostasis is the activation of the coagulation system, which is triggered by a tissue factor, which is also present below the endothelium. And using the phospholipid complex, thrombin is activated, then fibrin is polymerized, and this is like the cement or the glue that holds all platelets together. And this is the formation of the blood clot. And the tertiary hemostasis is mainly focused on plasmin. Plasmin is a protein that degrades the fibrin and the clot, and what is happening is that the healing vessel regains its vascular patency after this stage. But today we use a newer model. It's a cell-based model that describes coagulation as like in three parts. First of all, the initiation part of coagulation, which tissue factor and factor and activated factor 7 complexes, they are formed at the site of the tissue injury. Then they activate factor 10 and factor 9, and then they generate small amounts of thrombin. This is the initiation phase. Now the amplification phase is when thrombin activates platelets, and thrombin also stimulates its own production by activation factors 5 and 8. And then coagulation factors assemble on surface of activated platelets. And the third phase is the propagation phase, where assembled complexes continue to cascade on surface of activated platelets. Prothrombin is converted to thrombin, fibrinogen is converted to fibrin, and the clot is stabilized. Now I will move to the second part of my talk, which is laboratory testing. And you know, when we take laboratory screen of hemostasis for newborns, we see that they have longer activated prothrombin time, they have also longer prothrombin time, and they have longer bleeding time and thrombin time. And they reach the adult values at about between 16 years and few months of those states. one. Now, the concept of developmental hemostasis was coined by the late Dr. Maureen Andrew, who was a pediatric hematologist from Canada, and she said that age-related physiological changes occur in the coagulation system. But understanding this situation in neonates is poor due to the need for multiple reference ranges that are required. The great variability necessitates even larger patient cohorts. And blood sampling is technically difficult in those patients, and you can draw only small blood samples, and that requires micro techniques to be used. And she also said that the hemostatic system is dynamic and evolving process that is age dependent, and components of hemostasis are synthesized in early fetal life, and they do not cross the placenta. She said the hemostatic system of the young is effective, and healthy infants do not experience spontaneous hemorrhagic complications. But she also said that infants are more vulnerable to serious hemostatic complications from either congenital or acquired hemostatic defects compared with older children and adults. Now, the components of the developmental hemostasis that undergo age-related changes are three. First is the blood vessel wall, then it's the platelets, and the third one is the coagulation proteins, and I will review each one of them. The vascular endothelial changes with age, and this is the least studied component of the hemostatic system, and we know that it is the critical regulator of plasma levels of coagulation proteins. Now, endothelial function is highly species and organ specific, and we don't know how much we can extrapolate from animal studies to humans. So this is remains partly unknown. Now, we know that platelet changes with age. We know that megakaryopoiesis has been difficult to study in the fetus in the neonate. We know that performing those studies, the platelet function studies on Corda, they revealed conflicting results. And we know that traditional platelet function studies in newborns are almost impossible to perform because of the large volumes we need to do. We do know that platelet numbers are stable and no matter of the gestational age or the age of the newborn, and they are relatively stable. But the coagulation proteins, this is the most studied aspect of developmental hemostasis, and we know that there is a variation in the human plasma proteome as a whole, and also inside of that, the coagulation proteins also do change between newborns and adults. And this is from the Andrew's original works. I will show you now a few slides on that. You can use them as references. I will not go through each line, but I will just say that you can see that in full term, you can see that the activated prothrombin time is longer than in adults. Almost all the coagulation factors are lower. An exception is factor 8 and the volumen factor, which are higher or at least as the adult level. And you can also see that inhibitors of coagulation of the full term, also they tend to be lower, except from the alpha-2 macroglobulin, which inhibits thrombin and plasmin, and the alpha-1 antitrypsin, which inhibits coagulation. And those two are not low. And you can see the same picture in premature infants, which this picture is maybe more pronounced, maybe more. And you can see it even better. APTT is longer, and the factor 8 and von Willebrand are higher, and the inhibitors of coagulation as well. And the fibrinolytic system of a full term, you see that tissue plasmin activator and plasmin activator inhibitors, they are higher than in the adults, and you can see that picture also in the premature newborn. Now, if I sum up all those lab values, I would say that at birth, the plasma levels of most coagulation factors, including the vitamin K-dependent factors, are around half that measured in adults. We see that preterm newborns have even lower levels than the full terms. We see that adult levels are reached at few months to 16 years. And the International Society of Thrombosis and Hemostasis recommends that each lab defines the age-dependent reference ranges using its own technical conditions. I have not seen that being done, at least in Israel, but maybe in your country it is done. But they recommend that each lab would do its own lab reference, including newborns and premature newborns. But the big question for me is why do plasma levels of coagulation proteins change with age? What advantage does it give the neonate to be at that situation? And as Albert Einstein said, if you can't explain it simply, you don't understand it well enough. And I think, since I cannot explain it simply, probably we do not understand it. I think this is the case in developmental hemostasis. But at least I can maybe give a partial answer for that, because the hemostatic system interplays with other processes, like the immune and inflammatory responses, like angiogenesis, like wound repair, and those processes, you can intuitively say why those processes are developmental. Let's say angiogenesis, it is intuitively understandable to know that the fetus needs to make angiogenesis, while adults, it may be something which is not so good. So for example, antithrombin is a potent anti-angiogenic properties, and it is reduced in newborns. So maybe this is some answer for that. So now I would like to move to the last part of my talk, which is practical aspects for you neonatologists, and to maybe something that you can take home with you. So I would like to introduce a simplified clinical and laboratory approach for the differential diagnosis of bleeding in a newborn, and it divides the bleeding newborn into two health states. It can be either if it's sick newborn or a healthy one, if it looks sick or looks healthy. If it is a sick newborn and its platelets are low and its PT and APTT are long, you should think of DAC. If the infant is sick, its platelets are low and he has normal PT and PTT, you should think of platelet consumption. Maybe it is an infection or neck or renal vein thrombosis or something this kind. If the newborn is sick, its platelets are normal, PT and PTT are long, you should think of liver disease or maybe heparin effect. And if he's sick and platelets, PT and PTT are normal, you should think of maybe some altered vascular integrity, maybe extreme prematurity or severe hypoxia and acidosis. Now, if the infant looks healthy and his platelets are low, his PT and PTT are normal, you should pick maybe an immune cause for thrombocytopenia or cult infection or thrombosis, or maybe even some congenital bone marrow failure. If platelets are normal and PT and PTT are elevated, you should think of vitamin K deficiency. If platelets and PT are normal, just the PTT is higher, you should think of hemophilia, maybe A or B. And if all tests are normal, you should think of bleeding due to trauma or some anatomic abnormalities or some qualitative platelet defects. Now, about 40 years ago, there were four studies published about the connection of intraventricular hemorrhage and developmental hemostasis. And in those four studies, they tried to supplement coagulation factors and to see how that affects intraventricular hemorrhage tendency or frequency. And what they all found that the prophylactic administration of proton beam complex concentrate, it tended to improve survival. And those four studies made me and my colleagues published a few years ago, some reviews, opinions, maybe speculations. We did not do any clinical study. We thought of, but we did not do it, about maybe there's something to do with coagulation and intraventricular hemorrhage. And you have those references, you can look at them, but we did not do any real clinical study on that. Now I will touch on few clinical scenarios which are connected to bleeding. The first one is vitamin K deficiency. You know that vitamin K dependent coagulation factors are 2, 7, 9, 10 protein C and protein S. It's obvious. And why? The question is, why do newborns lack vitamin K? And the answer is that they lack all sources of vitamin K. They have a sterile gut. They have low vitamin K content of the human milk. And also about this, there's a poor placental transfer of vitamin K to the fetus. And we can divide this clinical syndrome into three subtypes: the early one, the classical, and the late one. Which the early one occurs in the first 24 hours, and it is usually due to maternal medications that inhibit vitamin K. The classical one occurs between 1 day and 7 days of age, and it's usually because of lack of prophylaxis of vitamin K in breastfed infants. And the late one occurs in exclusively breastfeeding or poor feeding, and they tend to present with bleeding. So how do we treat vitamin K deficiency? Of course, we have the best way is to prevent it. But in those cases, we supplement the vitamin K either intramuscularly or intravenously with vitamin K or with prothrombin complex concentrate, which I will touch a little later. Another clinical scenario is liver failure, is neonatal liver failure. And the most frequent causes are viral hepatitis, hypoxia, shock, hydrops, and etc. Now, don't forget that the liver is the source of coagulant, anticoagulant factors, and also thrombopoietin. So that may cause either bleeding or thrombosis, or both. And the neonates usually present with elevated PTT, elevated D-dimer, and decreased fibrinogen and platelet count. And you should bear in mind that without hepatic recovery, the replacement therapy will be futile. So how do we treat those patients? First of all, they may develop secondary vitamin K deficiency, so we have to replace vitamin K deficiency. And we also have to replace factors. Now, if we use the fresh frozen plasma, it may cause volume overload. If you use the recombinant factor 7A, that may cause thrombosis. So it is preferable to use prothrombin complex concentrate and or cryoprecipitate as needed. And I will touch a little bit later about the prothrombin complex concentrate. Another clinical situation which you may run into is DAC. Now, in DAC, there is consumption of procoagulant, of anticoagulant, of fibrinolytic proteins, and also of platelets. And hemorrhagic and or thrombotic complications may occur. And there is always underlying medical disorder in those situations. In neonates, it's usually sepsis. Now, the treatment, it should be given to manage bleeding or thrombotic complications, not to improve laboratory values. Now, since DAC is a prothrombotic at its basis, so if you give coagulation factors and infuse platelets, it's like pouring oil on the fire. So you should avoid that just if it is needed. Now, the last clinical scenario is therapeutic hypothermia. And as all of you know, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy plus its treatment, which is therapeutic hypothermia, may cause high rates of coagulopathy. So platelet counts of below 130,000, low fibrinogen levels, and the high PT, they were associated with clinical bleeding. So what one should do is to monitor platelet count coagulation measures and clinical signs of bleeding. This slide is important just for the doses because I have seen several mistakes in that and I thought that should be brought here. The doses of hemostatic therapies that we use in newborn. So platelet concentrate, the dose is 10 milliliters per kilogram. The fresh frozen plasma is 10 to 20 milliliters per kilogram, and the cryoprecipitate is 10 milliliters per kilogram to achieve good hemostasis. Now, in this slide, I just put the minimum hemostatic value of each factor so you can use, and also the source for this replacement. I will not review it, you have it, but just for use. Now I want to ask you a question. How many of you have used proton beam complex concentrate? No one. Oh, one, two. Okay. So most of you do not use the proton beam complex concentrate. Now, proton beam complex concentrate is a concentrate which has the vitamin K dependent factors, which mean 2, 7, 9, and 10, protein C and protein S. And it turns out that it is more effective and more rapid than fresh frozen plasma in replacing coagulation factors. It can be infused faster and the volumes are less, and this is something very important for you, the question of volume. So with less volume, you need shorter preparation time, you don't need to thaw it, you don't need to blood type or blood match, and the indications for this product is replacement therapy for congenital or acquired deficiency of vitamin K dependent clotting factors, and this is the dose is 25 to 50 units per kilogram of the factor 9 of the factor 9. You can see the commercially available proton beam complex concentrate and the countries which you can find, so you can find your own country and see what commercially available product you have. And also you can see here the content of each of this commercially available product, and you have to calculate the dose by the factor 9. Okay, this is the way you give it. But 3 months ago, systematic review and a meta-analysis was published, and they were reviewing 8 studies, and this systematic review indicates that there is insufficient evidence to recommend the use of PCC in neonates and infants, and more observational studies are needed. But until that happens, I personally use this product, and I see that it is very safe and very effective, at least in my experience. And I would like to finish with a few slides that I will speak about neonatal thrombosis. Until now I spoke about hemostasis, about bleeding, few implications of this topic on neonatal thrombosis. Now, the low levels of factor 9, 11, and 12, they result in APTT prolongation by unfractionated heparin that is often greater than the anti-10A activity, which is the real activity of the heparin. So you should either, if you treat the patient with unfractionated heparin, you should either monitor by anti-10A activity, or you should treat him with low molecular weight heparins instead. Because of the unreliable vitamin K intake, you should prefer the low molecular weight heparins over Coumadin, over the vitamin K antagonist. And another point is that the prothrombotic contribution of factor 5 laden and the prothrombin mutation is not known and probably not a strong risk factor for perinatal thrombosis. Now, what are the implications of the natural anticoagulant on neonatal thrombosis? Now, tissue factor mediated coagulation activation is dominant in newborn infants. So disorders that express increased tissue factor, like sepsis, like inflammation, like vascular damage by catheters, are strong prothrombotic to this population. Another point is that antithrombin and protein C concentrates, they offer supportive care for neonates. And the genetic deficiency of protein C, protein S, and antithrombin, they can present as perinatal stroke and renal event thrombosis, VAC, and purpura fulminans. And the implications of fibrinolysis for neonates, we know that fibrinolysis is physiologically balanced with thrombus formation in neonates. We know that newborns require somehow higher doses of tissue plasmin activator. We know that plasminogen replacement with FFP in concomitant with TPA, it maximizes the therapeutic fibrinolysis. We know that poor resolution of renal vein thrombosis may be related to prenatal onset and clot organization. And you should be careful, of course, with thrombolysis when expected high risk for IVH. Now, I would like to sum up my talk. I was talking about the pathophysiology and pathophysiology of developmental hemostasis. I talked about diagnosis as well as therapeutic considerations. So with that, I would like to thank my family for their support, to thank you for listening to me, and I will be happy to take any questions.